morning. Trying to wake everybody up. Good morning. I think we're going to get started relatively on time. My name is Karen Jacobs, and I'm the director of the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute, or OLLI, as we like to call it, here at Sonoma State University. And it is my great pleasure to welcome you to our winter course preview. I trust all of you are looking forward to the holidays and will return in January, ready to fill your mind with new information and wonderful classes that you'll hear about this morning. As many of you know, this represents our 15th year of OLLI at Sonoma State University. And that first year, we served just over 500 students in the academic year. We have now tripled in size and are serving over 1,600 students every year, which is a wonderful achievement. And I always like to ask, as we talk about our history, how many people in this room were here that first year in 2001? Would you please raise your hands? Wow. Okay, loyalty. Very nice. And how many of you have been with the program for 10-ish years? Another huge show of hands. Thank you very much. And how many of you for 5 years or so? Fantastic. And the most important question, how many of you are here today for the first time? Wonderful. Fantastic. So all of you are part of a national network of over 150,000 lifelong learners who participate in Osher Institutes on college campuses across this country. We were the second of those institutes to be established among 119, and we're very proud of that. All of those institutes are founded, at least in part, through the generous support of the Bernard Osher Foundation. And I had the pleasure of meeting Mr. Osher at a conference recently. He is indeed a remarkable man who not only envisioned those institutes and the network that has grown to this size all of those years ago, but he also just celebrated his 88th birthday with a surfing lesson. In addition to the Osher Endowment, which he started, this program, as you know, relies on tuition from course fees and on private donations to support itself. Many of you have already given generously to our end of year campaign to acknowledge our 15th anniversary, and I thank all of you for your support of this program. But there is another way that you can help. Imagine if even one quarter of our students, there are 1,600 of you, so let's say 400 of you were to bring one friend, neighbor, or relation to join you in your journey of lifelong learning. Can you imagine what an impact that would have on this program? 200 of you are here today, and roughly another 200 will be at the Oakmont Open House on Wednesday. So I hereby challenge those 400 people to bring one friend, neighbor, or relation with you to OLLI this term or in the spring or in the summer. And if indeed we reach 2,000 students by the end of this academic year, I promise, with a lot of witnesses, to throw a party in your honor here at the university. We will raise a glass together to OLLI's 15th year and to a 2,000 student population milestone, and I hope to be there with you at the end of the summer. Is it a deal? Excellent. We have witnesses to that, too. Okay. I printed my notes in 14-point font for the first time instead of 12 today, and it really helps. It's good. So now that we're all feeling motivated to share the treasure of OLLI, let's get back to what makes this program what it is, and that is our curriculum. We have a wonderful roster of new courses this year, and I would like to thank a couple of people who have helped make that possible. I would like to thank Barbara and Les Brooks for partially underwriting Bill Garrett's class on anti-intellectualism, and an anonymous donor for underwriting Michelle Anna Jordan's class. You too can be part of this group that makes classes possible through OLLI, and for $3,500, underwrite a class that covers both the space rental at the Cooperage and the stipend for the instructor. If you'd like to look into that further, if you're a groupie of a particular instructor or passionate about a particular topic, I would be happy to talk to you about that. Or if you'd like to get together with a group of friends and make that possible, I would love to discuss that with you as well. So for those of you who are keeping score, that's not one, not two, not three, but four ways you can support this program. Contribute to the year-end appeal, bring a friend to a class, underwrite a class, or on the registration form in the new catalogs that most of you are holding, there is a spot for a donation right on the reg form. We made it really easy this year. So, four ways. Okay, each instructor, as you know today, will have 5 minutes to share with you their class. I will be sitting in that chair as timekeeper. I will be looking at my phone, not because I'm surfing the internet, but because I'm keeping track of time, and I will let people know when they are approaching time, but I have a feeling most of these folks are going to be just fine. They will come to the stage in the order that they're listed in the catalog, and I've shared with all of them that you are a very discriminating, discerning crowd, and they are to put their best foot forward. So here we go. Starting with a new instructor to us, but somebody who has taught for a number of other OLLI programs in the Bay Area, as well as practicing law, I bring to the stage Eric Zinrod.
My 5 minutes has not started yet. And I have time this, so. Thank you very much.
Right and left. Good morning. You guys ready to kick this thing off? All right, good. You like the pretty slide? I have 250 slides already prepared for our six classes, so we're ready to go. Why does international law matter? Because no longer can we be isolationists like we were before the prior world wars. The world has become a much smaller place. We're interconnected by the internet and mass transportation. After all, it really is a small world. Did you know that 3,000 years ago, there were 600,000 independent world communities? Now they're less than, guess, 200. And when a disease develops like Ebola in Africa, it can come here. If SARS arises in China, it can come here. The world is now sitting on 20,000 nuclear weapons. Are we there? Yes, we are. That's the equivalent of 200,000 Hiroshima bombs. 100 million people were killed in 20th century wars. Right here in California, we're driving Japanese and European cars. McDonald's is served in 120 countries right now, with 60 million customers served daily. Coca-Cola is served 1 billion times a day in every single country. Starbucks, one of our new companies, is in 50 countries. And you can even get your decaf, double tall, wet calf, cappuccino in at the Great Wall of China. My point here is we become a very interconnected small world. And what that also means is disputes are easy to develop, and we need to deal with those. So in week one, we're going to talk about the big picture. What are the sources of international law, like treaties, customs, judicial opinions? But it can be murky, and we sort of make it up as we go along as a world, because there's no one controlling judicial system like we have here in our country. For example, when the US went to Pakistan to root out bin Laden, was that okay? Was that a war? Is that permissible? We'll talk about nations versus states. A state is a recognized country. A nation is a similarly situated cultural group of people. We'll learn that in our country, we have 11, at least 11 different cultural groups, and we're located in the left coast of all places. We're gonna talk about international organizations. You recognize that as the UN. We'll talk about the failed League of Nations and why, and how come World War I was not the war to end all wars. We'll talk about how the UN's working, and frankly, not working. That's week one. Week two, we're gonna talk about human rights violations. You probably recognize this from the Nuremberg trials. That's when human rights issues really started to develop as an international concern, because human rights violations go beyond sovereignty within one country. We as an entire planet need to deal with that. And we'll be talking about genocide, torture, slavery, and rape, and how we deal with that on a global basis. But often, and I'm going quickly because I have 5 minutes, well, take it more measured when you're in my class. But often countries do not intervene, and we'll find out that the U.S., our country, actually has not signed off on certain human rights treaties and conventions. And we'll talk about a case I had before the Supreme Court dealing with Haitian boat people who were trying to escape repression in their country, and they took these tiny rafts to go across the high seas and come to Florida, and what happened to them. In week three, we're going to talk about war and peace. We'll talk about the ethics of just wars. When is war truly justified? What are the rules vis-a-vis combatants and civilians? There are some rules, believe it or not. How do we deal with the massive effects like atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki? When is that justified? Yet the UN Charter discourages the use of force, except for self-defense. But what is appropriate self-defense? And anticipatory self-defense. When we went into Iraq to find weapons of mass destruction, which were not there, was that true self-defense? Because that was the justification. And if we have what's called anticipatory self-defense, are we setting very bad precedent for countries like Pakistan and India who are sitting on nuclear weapons? What if they want to take each other out because of supposed self-defense? That's week three. I think that was week three, war and peace. Week four, the new world disorder. We'll talk about cyber warfare. We'll talk about terrorists. How do we go about dealing with ISIS in the wake of Paris and other atrocities? We'll talk about slavery and human trafficking, and an issue that's important but doesn't show up too much in the news, the looting and destruction of antiquities. Week five deals with the earth, the law of the sea, land, air, and space. Who controls the oceans in terms of navigation, resources, and military purposes? Who controls the air and space above our countries? When can unauthorized aircraft be shot down? We'll be talking about the environment. Rivers can actually catch fire. Do you remember this one? That's the Cuyahoga River outside of Cleveland in the 1960s. We're going to talk about environmental issues. What happens when one country dumps upriver from another country? Right now, we're breathing air pollution particulates from China here in Northern California. Of course, we need to address global warming and the recent Paris Agreement that took place in the last week. We'll talk about a $1 billion cleanup case that I had that dealt with 70 years of pollution caused by military manufacturing operations. I think I'm on time. Week six, we're gonna deal with hot international crises at that moment. So I'm not gonna tell you what those are right now because I don't know. But in a few weeks, we will know. Last but not least, are you ready to rock and roll? Okay? We're gonna rock and roll in my class, okay? I am your lawyer, you are my jury. This has been my opening statement. This is what I intend to prove in my class, and you're gonna render the verdict at the end. So I hope you're up to joining me on this international journey. Did I come in at 5 minutes? Great. It's really a pleasure to be here. I hope you'll take my class. We really will have fun and we will learn. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. 5 minutes exactly. All right, keeping up with our international thread here, which will dominate a good part of the morning, I would like to introduce somebody who was one of our very popular instructors with her last course, The Ebb and Flow of Civilizations. She comes to us from the junior college. She's quickly become one of our favorites, and she's taking us now to South America in our international journey, Ty Benoit.
Good morning, and it's wonderful to be back here for another sojourn. I want to explain to you where we're going to sojourn to. Unlike Eric's class, we're going to go a little bit back in time, but we will bring it to the present. And here's an image of one of the key places that we'll be visiting. How many of you have been here? I figured it's the top archaeological tourist site in South America. And for those of you who haven't been here, we're going to take you on quite a journey. So this is Machu Picchu, one of the sites that was part of the Inca Empire and known to the people who lived at that time as Tahuantinsuyu, or the land of the four corners. So we're going to kind of use that theme. If you've been to Machu Picchu, how many of you looked at Machu Picchu from this perspective? This is climbing to the top of Huayna Picchu, looking down at the bus route that goes up to the... So you didn't see that if you didn't climb up to the top, but we're going to take a look at some of the new discoveries, some of the things that have just been excavated, some of the things that are not being excavated at this time, but perhaps while our class unfolds, we'll get some news about whether they'll be able to open the door and find out if the tomb of Pachacuti really is behind that door. If you joined into a tour of Machu Picchu, you probably started it about 100 miles away, 2,500 feet higher, in Cusco. And maybe you didn't remember it as much, or those of you who haven't gone, because of the altitude sickness that you were experiencing while you were there. And so this trip that we're going to take, you, I promise you won't get any altitude sickness, okay? You might have some of those views that make you a little dizzy, but no altitude sickness. And when we talk about Cusco as one of the major places that is part of this Inca Empire, we need to find out a lot of answers to questions. For instance, here's Sacsayhuaman overlooking Cusco. And you notice the big stones that are there. One of the questions that's baffled scholars is, how did they get these stones to build these structures, these pathways? And for those of you who took my course on the ancient Egyptians and the Maya doing sort of a comparison, we're going to take that to new levels, looking at how these structures were built. Without the use of the wheel, how did they get those stones to build these structures? That's only one of the questions that we're going to try to answer. So when we look at Tahuantinsuyu or the Inca Empire, you notice that the dates are very, very short. You've got the Spanish coming in, conquering this area of the world. We know what happened to it after 1525. But what we don't often realize is how many civilizations were absorbed by that empire, and how grand and wonderful those civilizations were. Here's a couple of images from the Moche culture, or Chimor. And I'm sure that if you've traveled to this area, or even read about it, you're not as knowledgeable about these civilizations. So in listening to former OLLI participants, instead of comparing two civilizations on different continents, what I'm trying to do is to stay on the same continent, but to give you some insight into these amazing mysteries that existed. Now, we're all old enough to remember the 1970s, and the Nazca culture, for instance, was one of those that was popularized by Eric von Däniken, right? Remember some of the things that he was trying to suggest. We'll deconstruct some of von Däniken's theories, because he suggested that these were, you know, ancient astronauts that came in and created this civilization. But we'll visit Nazca, which predated the Inca, but was absorbed by the Inca Empire. We'll also visit this area of South America along the coast to the north of Cusco and Machu Picchu. Anybody been to Chimor? We've got a couple people, much less visited. Chan Chan, the city that is depicted here, one of the biggest cities in the Americas around 1400, and a city that confronted some of the very same issues that we're confronting today, extreme drought, and then the impact of El Nino, and that civilization, again, eventually absorbed by the Inca, but we'll look at what the lessons are that we can learn from these various civilizations that predated the Inca. And again, because of so many questions that came out from the previous class that I taught, we'll make some connections between this fascinating area in South America and some of the Mesoamerican civilizations that are depicted here, like the Maya, the Aztecs. There were a lot of questions in my Oakmont class last session about the Aztecs, so I had to figure out how to incorporate a little bit of that as a comparison. And then, you know that I like to talk about the ancient past, but I'm also very interested in the concepts that Eric expressed about current situations. So we'll look at what's happened to the Quechua people since 1500, since the Spanish conquest. And here you have depicted a Spanish manuscript from the 1500s with a modern photograph that shows Quechua-speaking people wearing their quipus. And these were things that they used to keep records of their past and to monitor some of their business transactions. So very much alive still in terms of the culture that exists in Peru and Ecuador. And we'll look, just as Eric is, at the environment and some of the environmental challenges and whether the indigenous movements that have surfaced in these areas of the world have had a dramatic impact on some of the challenges that we confront today in terms of the earth. And so I invite you to join me in the Cooperage on Mondays from 1 to 3 for this South American sojourn, and we'll have a great time again analyzing the ebb and flow of these particular civilizations. So I look forward to seeing you there. Thank you.
Thank you, Ty. So we continue our international journey now with a gentleman who has been with OLLI for a couple of years. He's involved with the World Affairs Council. He's taught down in Santa Barbara County. He's participated on the OLLI Finance Committee. He's getting involved every which way he can, for which I am very grateful. He drew rave reviews last term, and he's taking us to his favorite part of the world again with French and American experience in Indochina, Perry Rittenour.
Sorry. Thank you, Karen. Good morning, everyone. Today I'm introducing a new class, Indochina, the French and American Experience from 1854 to 1975. Let me hasten to add, this isn't a war story. It's not about the Vietnam War, the American War. It's a story about a revolution of ideas and cultures, of things like westernization, modernization, the role of monarchy and tradition in ancient societies, and how the West and westernization impacted these very, very traditional ancient societies. Historically, this area termed Indochina was defined by the French during the 100 years of colonialization over these three kingdoms that we now term Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos. Today, we're known as Southeast Asia rather than Indochina. Let's take a look back at what the Europeans might have seen back 1,500 years or so ago about what that might have looked like. This was a map of what Europeans at that time saw from a cartography point of view for Eurasia and Africa. And this small area, right along in here, was what they thought of as in what we call today Southeast Asia, Indochina. And you can see it wasn't very much. There's a slight line drawn down the middle, which I think was probably the Mekong River. When this map was drawn, Vietnam had already experienced 500 years of occupation by the Chinese. So this wasn't a completely absent area without any civilization or existence. Today, we recognize these countries as countries of Southeast Asia, including Thailand, Burma, and Malaysia, all together, along with their large uncles to the north and to the west, India and China, which certainly had a very dramatic influence on these countries, hence the term Indo-China. Let's further define what this class will cover. We're going to look at the Indochina, these three Indo-Chinese states, from two historical perspectives. The colonial period, which would be basically the French occupation from 1854 to 1954, when France occupied and controlled these three kingdoms, and the name Vietnam really didn't exist on the map. Here's a French map of what the French saw as French Indochina, and you can see there's not much to be seen in the way of definition. There's something missing there. I wonder if anybody can see it. What happened to the country of Laos? It's not there. That's an example of how French cartographers may have overlooked certain societies in this area. The second period we're going to look at is the Cold War. The Cold War, basically, from 1954 to 1975, includes a new country, which was created by the Americans, called South Vietnam, as contrasted to North Vietnam, across the 17th parallel, in an attempt to create some new construct create a new ideological barrier against what was seen as a threat of communism coming from the north. Today, we see a united Indochina of countries that are now at peace and largely unified among themselves, and now are forming into an economic collaborative called ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, principally an economic collaborative, but also leading to more and more toward political and military cooperation. What are our goals for this class? Well, to understand the existing cultures and political structures of Indochina, what caused the French to come to Indochina? The French were relatively late coming into the colonial efforts. England had gone into India much earlier, and China seemed to be the large goal for everyone to pursue. What made the French essentially go into Indochina? How did they go about colonizing and controlling Southeast Asian cultures and kingdoms to form the French Union of Indochine, which is the French term they use, with very few troops and many administrators, along with the French secret police, the Sûreté? And what went wrong with that French experience in what they called the mission civilisatrice, or the civilizing mission, which the French foresaw as their goal in going forward? What other goals? When and why did the Americans intervene in Indochina? To save the French, to stop the Chinese from expanding communism, to satisfy domestic politics after the war in Korea. America's efforts at Pax Americana from 60 to 67 included terms which all of us are probably very well familiar with, the Viet Cong, the Buddhists, and the Diems. And then America's failure in Indochina from 67 to 75, when issues such as Tet, Hanoi, China, and the Soviet Union all became buzzwords in terms of our lexicon over this area. In conclusion, I think we should characterize this area as one spectacularly beautiful area that remains for all to see today, but there are still the scars of war. But what's different is that the population here is very young. Most of the population in these countries didn't have any experience in that American war that all of us may have seen very up close and personal. So therefore, their reaction to that particular war, as well as the overall 120 years that we're going to be talking about, is very nominal in terms of how they see it. They look ahead to the future. Vietnam still, however, continues to exert strong political influence and military power over the rest of Indochina. It's still the dominant of the three countries. And there is still no democracy within Indochina. All three of these countries are less than democratic. I hope you'll join us in this journey back in time to your youth and our youth, to a place that we once all saw in the headlines about war, but is now at peace and open to all to experience. Just show you some quick slides to give you some flavor of what we might be talking about. All over Vietnam, because of those wars, you'll see graveyards. They're very, very sad. You'll see famous and ancient temples such as Angkor Wat, which many, I'm sure, you've been to. Cham temples along the Vietnamese coast of a civilization called Champa which has disappeared into the mists of history, and no one even talks about or even knows about. So I welcome you once again to come, and I hope you'll all come along to see us. We're going to be meeting on Tuesday, 9:30 to 11:30 in the Cooperage. It's an early time, but you get a great parking space that early. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Perry. Okay, we're going to stop our globetrotting for just a minute here and come back to the United States of America with somebody who we used to have a couple of instructors who we kind of called the Pied Pipers of OLLI. You know, they would teach it and you would come. And we've added to that list with somebody who in the last year and a half or so has become a favorite of this program. If you took Eric Williams' Supreme Court class, raise your hand. Uh-huh. Okay. Enough said. I give you the new Pied Piper of OLLI, perhaps, Eric Williams.
Hi, how are you? Wow, a lot of you took my class. That's great. If you saw Eric's map, there was a part in the upper right-hand corner called New England. The way you can tell a New Englander in California is they're the idiot wearing shorts in this weather. So that would be me. For those of you who, first of all, you know, it's such a pleasure to be back. About a year and a half ago, I taught a class up in Healdsburg. I didn't know what to expect. You know, I know my shtick works with 21-year-olds. I wasn't quite sure, you know, how it was going to play. And as it's turned out, it's become just such a great pleasure to come and teach. It's something I tell all of my friends and the faculty they should do at some point in their career. Those of you who took my first class, I want you to know, first of all, this is, although it's focused on the Supreme Court, this new class is going to be completely different from that first class. The first class, I really wanted to focus on the personalities, the justices, really speak a lot about who they were. You know, year after year, public opinion polls showed that the American Supreme Court is our most trusted branch of government. And I'm pretty sure that's because it's the least known branch of government. Justice Breyer could probably walk in here right now and none of you would recognize who he was. Scalia, probably you would. Clarence Thomas, I'm almost sure you would, for other reasons than just his fame. This time I really want to focus on the issues that the Supreme Court deals with, especially those that they've really dealt with throughout their entire history. A lot of us are unaware of how much, how entrenched some of these issues are in the law and how long the Supreme Court has been dealing with them. So the first week, we're going to really focus on how the Supreme Court became the Supreme Court. Because if you notice in the Constitution, you know, there's about 10 pages in a pocket constitution on Congress, about 8 pages on the presidency, and then a page and a half on the Supreme Court. And in many ways, the Supreme Court, in its early days, really defined its own role. They figured out for themselves what they were going to do and became a very much a co-equal branch of government with the other two. So I want to talk about how that sort of came about and the cases that the court used to bring that about. The next issue I want to talk about is going to be the second week we're going to spend on federalism. The relationship between the federal government and the states has very much been defined by the court. And if there has been one issue that the court has dealt with really since its inception, it's been this issue of where does power reside? Is it with the federal government or is it with the state? We're then going to move on to the Commerce Clause. The Commerce Clause is really one of Congress's most important powers. And it's the way that they justify passing laws such as Obamacare, one that we are all probably familiar with, and how the court over time has dealt with Congress's power to do that. Then we're going to get into sort of the more sexy issues in the Supreme Court, let's say. We're going to talk about discrimination after that. We're going to talk about, go all the way through the recent same-sex marriage decisions. from a couple of years ago. We're then going to talk about privacy, which is a really interesting area of law. The word privacy doesn't appear anywhere in the Constitution, and yet it's one of those rights that we really do hold dear. And it's been the Supreme Court who has sort of defined the parameters of what privacy means and what is protected. We're going to finish off by talking about criminal justice. I'm the chair of the Criminal Justice Department, so this is near and dear to my heart. We're going to talk about the so-called due process revolution of the 1960s and how the court has sort of dealt with the Fourth Amendment, the Eighth Amendment, the Fifth Amendment issues really since the real shift that happened with the court in the early 1960s. So I hope if you took my class the first time, I really hope you'll take this one. I promise it's going to be different. We're going to talk a lot about cases, go in depth on the case law. I hope it's a lot of fun for people. We had a really great turnout both at the Cooperage and then afterwards in Oakmont last spring. I'm going to be teaching in both places, both here and in Oakmont, so whichever one is more convenient. If you want to come to both classes, I guess you could do that too. I would think you'd get sick of me by then. But it's a lot of fun. I promise for those of you who took the class in the Cooperage the last time, I do not have to go to Maine for an election during this spring, and so I will not be Skyping into a class considering the disaster that was. So I hope to see lots of you in January. It really is a fun class. It's a class about an area of American politics that sadly we know too little about, I think, as a citizenship. And thank you guys for making me feel so welcome. So thanks.
Thank you, Eric. Okay, we're halfway through the program, and I'm going to ask you to take a little trip with me to something that is different. And it's different in a good way. We had an opening in our schedule unexpectedly, and we decided to get creative. And by we, I mean OLLI and the Center for Environmental Inquiry, which is located on this campus. How many of you have heard of the preserves at Sonoma State? Okay, the Center for Environmental Inquiry is, in its new iteration, the Sonoma State Preserves. They are looking now not about who they are, but about what they do, thus the new name. And the director of the Center for Environmental Inquiry, Claudia Luke, who is here today, was my co-conspirator in coming up with and thinking through an interdisciplinary look at the environment. As many of you know, one of the truths about academia is that it can be siloed and fragmented, and you have people who've taught here for 20 years in different departments who don't know each other, who've never met each other. And we thought, what would happen if we put the artists and the scientists in the same room and made them talk about a common theme? So we've talked about the environment a little bit. Ty will be touching on it in her course. Eric mentioned it in his class. And it's certainly, it's a contemporary topic of concern to almost everyone. And we thought, okay, we have a topic. We have guest speakers from art and science from across this campus. But how are we going to tie it all together? Who do we know that's really good at asking questions? And who do we know that can moderate conversation between people that don't usually talk to each other? And who do we know that's also interested in the environment? Well, many of you may know of Jonah Raskin. Jonah is an emeritus faculty member of both the communications department and the English department here at Sonoma State. He is a journalist. He speaks all over the county. His most recent book of many was on the wilderness, I'm not going to come up with the right name, but it's about the environment, and he is a friend of OLLI, he has taught for our program, and he was the missing piece. So he is going to come and tell you about the class, about the 8 guest speakers, and why this all matters. Mr. Jonah Raskin.
Thank you very much. Yes, so I can add to my resume now the missing link. Yes, sometimes people ask me if I'm any kind of IST, and I usually say that I'm an artist, though I would recently I've been adding to that I'm also an environmentalist. I'm not sure if that's saying very much because everybody these days is an environmentalist, even the heads of the big petrochemical corporations. So I am going to be teaching or moderating the class on the environment that meets Wednesday mornings in January and February, though my voice will not be the only voice that you will hear. There will be 9 of us all together, all of us weighing in with diverse perspectives on the same subject. From where I stand, there's nothing more important or more critical than the environment, now more than ever before in a time of catastrophic climate destabilization, rising ocean levels, melting polar caps, growing numbers of endangered species, and more violent storms. And of course, our own fragile environment here in Northern California is changing more quickly than ever before, with more people, more houses, more vineyards, more cars, and more demands for water than ever before. The environment is the issue for our time. All around the world, people are increasingly aware of how vulnerable our little planet is. I will be joined in this groundbreaking interdisciplinary cross-cultural lecture series by professors from the humanities and sciences, biology, chemistry, astronomy, and theater arts, Michael Schwager, Steve Farmer, Deborah Hammond, Dan Crocker, Paul Draper, Lynn Kaminsky, Liz Birch, and Laura Watt. Topics include eco-art, food and water, and black holes in outer space. As Karen explained, I did not devise this course. It's her brainchild and also Claudia Luke's. But when I heard about it and was invited to be the facilitator, I jumped aboard. Inquiry into the nature of the environment or environments is at the heart of this class. We will explore new territories and I hope expand the ways that you have thought and are thinking right now about the various environments that you inhabit and that inhabit you. Yes, it's a two-way street. On the first day, I will give 2 1-hour talks with an intermission in between. Weeks 2 through 5, you'll hear talks from my colleagues, along with lively discussion and dialogue. At the end, I'll give a concluding talk that will synthesize the many different voices and ideas that we've heard. Throughout the series, you are invited to ask questions, make comments, and add to what will surely be a rich stew of ideas and experiences, a landmark in Sonoma County's cultural and intellectual history. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jonah. So some of you have asked for courses with multiple voices and more interaction and more dialogue. This is that. So if you're one of those people who's been writing me about that, you should sign up for this class. Okay, moving to a rather sobering topic in the world of lifelong learning, anti-intellectualism. I'm almost afraid to hear what Mr. Bill Garrett is going to tell us. Being in the business of lifelong learning, I will prepare myself, but I give you one of our favorites. He is a Renaissance man and interdisciplinary instructor in his own right, Mr. Bill Garrett.
It's very nice to be back. Don't laugh at him too much, okay? That's my dad. It's the face, a good face for anti-intellectualism, but at the same time, it's a bit of a caricature. Oftentimes, the images of anti-intellectualism that come to mind are humorous ones. But my favorite, which I didn't use here, is a guy holding up a sign, "Keep your government hands off my damn Medicaid." It's funny, and we laugh, and you remember seeing that on the news, right? And it was just a great hoot. But something much more serious is at issue here, is what I'm going to be suggesting in this course. The course will be rooted in history, but because anti-intellectualism is such an urgent, pressing matter in the 20th century, the focus will be on the present. What then is anti-intellectualism in the 21st century? To begin, we have to set it off from just plain ignorance. In the 14th century, for example, people in Europe were entirely ignorant of the microbial cause of disease. They weren't anti-intellectuals, they were simply ignorant. They didn't have very many choices, and it was a disaster when it came to dealing with what history has come to call the Black Death. By contrast, in the 21st century, anti-intellectualism does exist, and it is seldom rooted in ignorance. It really is. It's not the problem. It's not that people don't have the fact. Many people in the 21st century have made a choice. Some have chosen to believe, for example, to stay with epidemics and diseases. Some have chosen to believe that vaccination causes disease rather than prevents it, right? This is a choice that they've made. Many of those who've made that choice are people who are bright and well-educated. The same is true for those who have chosen to believe that scientific claims about climate change are simply fraudulent. These are choices that we make, and it's important not to confuse anti-intellectualism. I know, I sort of invited here, but it's important not to confuse anti-intellectualism with low intelligence or low education. Yes, many of the 21st century proponents are delicately described as low information voters. That's a way of saying they're dumber than a bag of hammers, right? But we'll say that they're low information voters. But an attempt to understand anti-intellectualism in our time, exclusively in their terms, is more an exercise in entertainment than in critical analysis. And that's what I worry about, because the stakes are too high to settle for entertainment. At issue here in the 21st century, and I don't want to be melodramatic about this, at issue in the 21st century is whether the American population of our day is capable of performing representative democracy, or are they just people that, I don't care, you got your truth, I got my truth, and I don't care. Well, this is a problem. It's a problem that will come to be catastrophic in time. Is this a flaw in the American character? No, you can see it all over Europe, you can see it all over the world. Is this a flaw woven into human nature itself? There's a hint for that, I think. The evolution of our species by means of natural selection didn't design our minds or the way that we think to be intellectuals, right? It designed them to survive. And if that sounds like a pessimistic thought, I'm going to be suggesting throughout the course that the fact that we are designed by evolution not so much to be thinkers, we will think when we have to, but we have been designed to survive, and that will be the key to how best resolve the crises that are besetting our culture at the present time. Again, our focus is going to be on the present, but we will begin by examining a critical era, the McCarthy era, which is familiar to many of us in this room. Everybody remember that? I remember it. I was a kid, but I remember the McCarthy era. It's a rich starting point because the dynamics of McCarthyism are becoming undeniably evident on our TV screens today. Have you noticed this? Haven't we seen it? This reminds me of my childhood. Why? Well, because some of the same nonsense is taking place. We will engage the vexed question of why so many people, so many reasonable people, I emphasize reasonable people, have come to doubt science. And our focus is not going to be on corporate shills or politicians who are doing it because they're engaging in the world's oldest profession, right? They do it for the money, right? I mean, we understand why they do it. We understand what they are. But what makes, what has happened to a population? How has the native curiosity that's born afresh with every healthy child come to be stultified into taking simplistic, nonsensical answers for profoundly exciting and complex questions? That's the thing that's something that befuddles me. We will also see that anti-intellectualism is not exclusively a red state disease, if you want to call it that. It's not just conservatives. It's not just a conservative passion. It permeates a lot of liberal thinking as well. I mentioned the anti-vaxxers. For the most part, they are well-educated liberals, and you can't present evidence that will be because they've got their truth. Where'd you get it? I got it off Google. Where did you go to school? And didn't you take a critical thinking class, or that you have to look at what your sources of your information are? But we'll talk about that in due course. We will examine the undeniable crises in American education, the cults of self-esteem, the cults of sensitivity that have come to pervade both public schools and our universities and colleges. How did wit, satire, and other forms of sharp-edged critique come to be scripted as microaggressions, or even as blasphemy? Has candor itself become suspect? How are we to deal with this? The approach of the course will be serious, but it will not be grim. We will have fun with this material. It's easy to do that to a certain extent, but we don't want to get lost in the fun either. We'll be looking at things, cultural innovations, how have they contributed? What is the difference between American culture before television and American culture after television? It's been said by some very careful social critics that it's not the same culture, but with a different technology. Television is an ecological introduction into the culture, and it makes for a different culture afterwards. So we'll consider the emergence of television, and in particular of cable television with its little private worlds for everybody, the emergence of the internet. These all contribute to a unique form of 21st century anti-intellectualism. The approach, as I say, will be serious but not grim. Every attempt will be made to avoid a recitation of all the usual suspects and their villainies. Evidence of that? I didn't say the name Donald even once. I hope to see you there.
Sobering indeed. Okay, so we are now going to, we've gone sort of from the macro global perspective to this country, and now we're going to take this to a regional focus. As many of you know, the courses that we offer fall into one of six primary subject areas: social and political history, world cultures, the arts, natural sciences, contemporary issues, and food and wine. So we are now going to migrate into the world of food and wine on a regional level with a local food journalist who writes for the Sonoma Index Tribune and Press Democrat. Okay, my publications are not on target today, clearly. Between Jonah, my apologies. She did a course for us last summer as part of our Taste Matters class. She is well known in the county. She is an alum of Sonoma State University and an author, and I'm looking forward to her historical presentation of Sonoma County agriculture, Michelle Anna Jordan.
Thanks so much, Karen, and thanks to all of you for being here. And I have to say, this is very much a lifelong learning experience for me. By the time my class starts on January 14th, I will have learned how to do a slide presentation. I'm very stubborn. I won't use Microsoft Word. And I haven't mastered Keynote yet, which is the Apple parallel. But that's okay, because I can talk. Before Sonoma County was wine country, before we were the Redwood Empire, before we were Sonoma County, we were known as the Abalone Nation. The Miwoks, the Kashayas, that was a large part of their diet. We're going to, in this class, go back and just do a quick overview of that part, and then we're coming forward to one of our favorite people, of course, Luther Burbank. I wanted to title this class, though I didn't even suggest it, A Potato and a Broken Heart. I don't know if that would have driven you away or brought you closer, but it was, in fact, a potato and a broken heart that brought Luther Burbank to Sonoma County. He was living in Massachusetts. He thought he was getting married. She broke his heart. He had already developed the Burbank russet potato. I think he had something like, 30 seed potatoes. He had a small number of seed potatoes. He sold them for $300 and had to get out of Dodge and away from that woman. The $300 was enough to fund his travel to Sonoma County. And in a certain way, the rest is history. It wasn't long before he called this area the chosen spot of all the world as far as nature is concerned. And that will be the thread that goes through the six-week class. In the first week, we're going to have a few other voices. Believe Gay LeBaron will be able to be with us. I'm hoping we can get Joe and Wally here. And we will be setting the stage for the history of farming in Sonoma County. We may even be lucky to coax Lou Preston off of his land to talk about the early days of Dry Creek Valley, which now is covered in it's a carpet of grapevines. But back when we were first farming here, the valley floor was used for the crops that could go to market, produce and grains. Lou Preston is one of the many people now who's reviving grain growing in Sonoma County. Wine was made predominantly for the family table, and it was grown on the less fertile lands on the hillsides. At that time, we grew a lot of apples. And at one point, we started taking apples out and we put grapes in. Sound familiar? Well, that happened in the 19th century. Those grapevines were pulled out. There were a number of blows culminating with prohibition, but before that, there was phylloxera, there was competition from Europe. So we have gone back and forth many times between grapes to apples, back to grapes to apples again, and there's a revival of the grape movement. So we'll be setting that stage in the first class. In the next four classes, we are going to be discussing things that were growing and being produced in Sonoma County in the 19th, 20th, and 21st centuries. We're going to be looking at things that have fallen by the wayside, such as prunes, for example, that may be making a little tiny comeback. And we're going to be asking a number of questions. One of those questions is, why eggs? How did that happen? And are there any parallels to how and why that happened happening in Sonoma County or California today? When did California olive oil first get a gold medal in Europe? It might not be when you think. What's the connection between the gas crisis of the 1970s, Crisco, and the new goat cheese movement? An industry was launched from that moment in our history. Duck, duck, goose. Turkeys and chickens, too. We might even take a little bit of a look at wild turkeys, which are a new introduced species that are omnipresent in Sonoma County now. We might even be able to get Norman Greenbaum to stop by. Norman was involved in the production of goat's milk before there was such an industry, and even though Spirit in the Sky may be his most famous song, one of his best songs is called Petaluma, and it's about raising hens and having his own eggs while he was living in Petaluma. One of the things we're going to explore a little bit, because I find it very interesting and it's crucial today, is marketing. How is Sonoma County produce, wine, agriculture in general, how is it marketed? How was it marketed? How important is that marketing? How honest is that marketing? And one big question, and if you're going to take my class, ponder this for a while and we'll have a great discussion. Who owns the name Sonoma? Did you know that Sonoma could be owned? Why does GMC get to have the name Sonoma on its truck? Is there really kosher sea salt being produced at a facility on the Sonoma coast? These are claims that are made. So we will look into that. We will look into farm trails, one of the most successful agricultural marketing programs in the United States ever, I think. We will look at Sonoma County, why that worked, why that failed. What's the go local movement? What's the made local movement? What are the requirements now that local, just like organic, has been given an official definition? We will definitely be exploring organic as well. Organic has changed. How has it, because the federal government now controls the term, how has that impacted Sonoma County? What is going on with GMOs, Frankenfish, which have now been approved? Are we going to accept that? Are we going to protest it? Is there ever going to be legislation locally that prevents GMOs from being grown here? What are the risks? What are the current economics of farming? That's a huge issue as property values rise. That influences everything to do with farming in Sonoma County. And if you look at housing prices, that can just make you want to go back to bed. But there's a lot, I feel like right now in our history is one of the most exciting times, and I'm thrilled to be able to talk about that and bring you speakers for the last day of class. We're also going to be doing some tastings. When we talk about olive oil, for example, we will definitely do some tasting. When we talk about the new apple movement, we will taste some ciders. Johnny Appleseed didn't plant apples for your table. He traveled America planting cider apples, and we are planting cider apples in Sonoma County again. So we will be tasting some cider as well. But on that last class, I'm going to bring in my hope for the future. Some young farmers some are from Sonoma County, some have families that have owned land here for 100, 150 years. They have maybe returned from getting degrees in all manner of genres to farm their land. There's a revival of the Grange Halls throughout America. There's a little bit of trouble with that in that Monsanto has been putting a lot of money into Grange Halls. It's ended up with a conflict in California, and some of the Grange Halls, including the one in Sebastopol, have pulled out of the national organization because of this infiltration by Monsanto. So we're going to talk to the new farmers movement, the young women farmers, the girl farmers, who are also beautiful. They may be putting out a calendar. There's a lot of talk about that. So on our last class, we will be talking about hope for the future, what will happen to land, what sort of legislation may be out there to support the continuation of farming in Sonoma County. Santa Clara County, if you go back and talk to people who have been there a long time, their biggest regret was not protecting their farmland. And there are a lot of people here that are dedicated to keeping our farmland viable for the next generation and all the generations to come. This is indeed the chosen spot, at least one of the chosen spots of nature. Everything we grow here seems to taste better. If you take Sonoma County produce to another region, our produce fetches 3 times as much money as produce from other parts of Sonoma County. So we will be exploring all this. We're going to have a fun time. We're going to have a delicious time. And I will have a fabulous slideshow for you because I will have learned and I'll be showing off and patting myself on the back. Thank you so much.
Okay, we're ahead of schedule. I can't believe this. So closing out this portion of the program is somebody who probably needs no introduction. How many of you have taken a class from Mick Chantler? Let me ask this another way. How many of you have not taken a class from Mick Chantler? Okay. Mick Chantler is a historian. Mick Chantler is a longtime OLLI friend as both student, instructor, now chair of our curriculum committee. He has spoken at the Legacy Luncheon. He teaches not only for this OLLI, but for the Berkeley OLLI and the Dominican OLLI, and I told him last night at a function that I might crown him the king of OLLI and find him a crown somewhere. Everything he does for this program is done with heart, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce Mick Chantler.
Well, thank you, Karen, for that lovely introduction. I think the good book says the last shall be first, and now I feel this is my opportunity to upstage Eric. The first shall be last? No, just kidding. My new course is entitled Statesmen and Rogues, America's Founding Fathers and Mothers. We're going to give due credit to the contributions made by women to the American Revolutionary period. I'm convinced that the revolutionary era, the founding as it's often called, is one of the two critical periods in American history which define our character as a people, the other one being the Civil War era, which I've taught several OLLI courses dealing with, and now we're going to return to our roots in this class. The revolutionary period officially ended in 1783 when America secured its independence from Great Britain, but really that was just the beginning of the process of working out the details, you might say, of the American Revolution. It took Americans at least another three decades to define the meaning of the American Revolution and to implement its values. And that is going to be the guiding theme for the course. I think of this class as a series of reflections on the inner meaning of the American Revolution. Not everyone who participated in the events of 1776 was in agreement about what the revolution stood for. George Washington, for example, did not even like to use the word revolution. He preferred to think of this as an independence movement. And many of the other more conservative members of the revolutionary era thought the same way. They didn't like the democratical, the word that was used at the time, the democratical implications of the word revolution, and instead tended to think of the whole event as a movement for home rule, nothing more. This was sort of like what Quebec experienced during the 60s and 70s, or the other separatist or home rule movements within the English-speaking world. Many other participants in the event, Thomas Paine, for example, was convinced that this was indeed a real revolution. The world turned upside down, as the popular song of the day had it. So we're going to look at not only what the participants of 76 thought the meaning of the revolution was, what was it really all about, but what Americans since that time have made of the revolutionary era. What do we think today the revolution stood for? What have our ancestors felt? And the way we're going to trace the evolution of that thinking is by looking at the careers of several participants in the events of that tumultuous period. Many of them are people you're very familiar with, but many of them are not going to be household names. We'll be talking, for example, about a woman named Theodosia Burr, the wife of Aaron Burr and the mother of another Theodosia Burr, and she is probably not someone that most of us know a great deal about, but I think she has a lot to tell us because in many ways she's the first feminist in American history, and her husband Aaron Burr, who is usually thought of as being one of the arch villains of the revolutionary period, was actually a very strong feminist advocate. Strange how history works. The first class that will take place, which is on Thursday afternoon, January 14th, will deal with the coming of the American Revolution. It will be an attempt to provide us with new perspectives that historians of the last 30 years or so have come up with to describe the meaning of the American Revolution. And so we'll look at the four predominant schools of historical interpretation as to what the revolution was all about. And I think that's going to be a critical framework setting lesson because the subsequent lessons will deal with the specific individuals who are the protagonists of the revolution. But we have to remind ourselves, what were the events that they experienced? What was the stage on which they were acting when they hammered out their own version of the revolution? Week two, of course, we'll have to delve into the life of the most prominent founding father of them all, George Washington. And I think what we'll find after week two is that this man really deserves the title Father of His Country. The man was an extraordinarily gifted, charismatic, creative statesman that was the glue, I think, that held America together throughout a 25-year period of time when we very easily could have crashed on the rocks of history and just fragmented into 13 or more separate little quarreling states. He made sure that didn't happen, and we'll see how he did that in week two. In week three, we're going to continue our look at George Washington with a shift in emphasis. We're going to look at Washington's sincere concern with the forgotten Americans. And I'm referring here now to the slaves, of course, and to Native Americans. All of the founding fathers, or most of them, I shouldn't say all, but most of them were slaveholders, which puts forth the paradox at the heart of a revolution that was supposedly all about human equality and freedom, and yet all these people were slaveholders. Washington, to his great credit, was troubled, deeply, deeply troubled by his ownership of human beings, and made up his mind in his last 2 years of life to do something about it. And he frees his slaves in his will so that he can make not only a statement for the nation, but to do the right thing before his maker. He knew his time was coming shortly. We're also going to see about his relationship with Native Americans. He was very troubled by the fact that if we were an extraordinarily new, innovative invention, you might say, in political science being acted out on the shores of America, but if the first thing we did as a people was to commit an act of genocide against the indigenous inhabitants here, something was radically wrong. And Washington wanted to move against that radical wrong, and we'll see how he did that. Obviously, he failed, but he gave it his very best effort to do something about the Native American question. In the next week, that would be week four of the class, we're going to look at Alexander Hamilton, the architect, really, of our financial system that we're still dealing with today. I mean, in many ways, he's probably the most important. He's not necessarily the nicest or the best in terms of moral fiber of the founding fathers, but I would argue that he is the most important because he gives us the economic world that we function in today, in its barest rudimentary forms, at least. He sends us on our way to becoming a thriving economic enterprise and the engine, you might say, of Western capitalism. Week five, we'll look at Benjamin Franklin. And if you think of Benjamin Franklin as, yeah, I like that one in the upper left there. He was a randy old fellow. We think of him as being kind of this paradigm of common sense, wisdom, you know, get up early in the morning, work hard, get to bed early at night, and you'll be fine. Actually, there's a lot more to Ben Franklin, as I think this picture in the upper left-hand corner. He's arguably America's first celebrity. He's a superstar. When he goes to France, French aristocrats fawn over him and want to touch him, literally. He's sort of the Elvis, and I don't mean that facetiously. I think he really is the first bona fide star of American culture, and we'll see why. And then week six, I love this picture. She gets my vote for Power Woman of the Week, I think. This is Molly Pitcher, a Revolutionary War heroine who will kind of serve as the springboard for our discussion of revolutionary women. What was the role played by women during this period? Legally, the answer is nothing, because legally, women didn't have any political voice in the 18th century. They could not sue in court or be sued because they were considered legally children in the wards of their husbands or fathers. They couldn't serve on juries. They certainly couldn't vote. And they certainly had no official voice in the ideology of the American Revolution. But I think we can all agree that there are a lot of ways that people make a contribution to a social movement other than by voting or by having an official legal voice in the proceedings. And women certainly did affect profoundly what went on during that 50-year period from 1763 to 1815, which is going to be sort of our boundary lines as we discuss this period. I want to close by saying I'm really very, very pleased to be able to teach a course about people whom I genuinely admire. That hasn't always been the case in some of my classes. I taught a class on Thomas Jefferson. Some of you may have taken that class, and it's really difficult for me to warm to Thomas Jefferson. I find his failings and his shortcomings in many ways to overshadow even his enormous accomplishments. But these people, Washington, Hamilton, Franklin, we'll also talk about James Madison, Thomas Paine, these were true giants on the earth, and I think they walked the talk and provided us with at least a framework to move forward in our experiment that's still happening today in promoting human equality and justice for all. So I hope you join me Thursday afternoons in this winter term. Thank you.
Thank you, Mick. So I'm just going to take one last minute here, since we're running a bit ahead of schedule, to do two quick things. I mentioned when I started this morning that this is our 15th anniversary. And we've done a lot of things to honor that 15th year, and there are more to come this spring. But I just wanted to share with you, we had the first annual Ed Stolman Memorial Lecture this fall, featuring Michael Krasny from NPR. How many of you in this room were there? Wonderful. Michael talked about honor and what it is to lead an honorable life. Some of our students have been invited this fall to speak in a sophomore year research and creative experience class that focused on the 1960s. And the coordinator of that class and I got together and said, none of these kids lived through the 60s. Wouldn't it be nice if OLLI students could come and talk about what it was to live during that time? The theme of that class the prior year was the Civil War. That didn't work so well, but the 60s worked well. Next year, I think it's the 1970s, and I think we'll do it again. We're also putting together a series of lunchtime talks. There will be three of them, one in February, March, and April, that will be in the library on the theme of the good life, which has been our theme for our 15th anniversary year. And they will feature faculty from across the Sonoma State campus coming on the lunch hour to talk about the good life, from Aristotle to immigration and the search for the good life, to the economy of the good life, and so forth. These will be between morning and afternoon OLLI classes, and there'll be brown bag lunch events for free in the library, and I'll make sure that they're in Gray Matters so you know that they're happening. And I also want to thank several people without whom all of the good work for these 15 years would not have happened. First and foremost, the other half of the OLLI team that works hard every day to support the entire program, Chris Alexander. Without her, I would probably run away and join the circus. She has elegantly put together today's program and does so much for OLLI. I can't begin to expound upon her talents. Of course, she left the room right before I mentioned her name. I would like to thank our advisory board, who works tirelessly to keep us going in the right direction and growing the program. I would like to thank our volunteer committees, curriculum, finance, and fundraising, with whom I work on a regular basis. And mostly, I would like to thank all of you for becoming what is a growing and loyal OLLI family to celebrate our 15th year. So I encourage you to meet one-on-one with instructors in the lobby to get to know each other. And I thank you for joining us today. Thank you very much.